Yes, welcome to the No Safe Project. I'm your host, Marc Stevens, author of Adventures in Legal Land. We're going to do our best to get through. I don't know how we're coming out on the feed, so if there's somebody on the No Safe Project chat, let me know how the audio is. Otherwise, we're going to have some issues. But it is February 22nd, 2014, live from the 45 compound in Phoenix, Arizona. Glad to be with you back. I was last week not here live, but we did have the Freedom Summit last week. We had that's where I was, hanging out with some friends, getting some really good video. So if you've gone to my YouTube channel, you can you can see the videos. I want to bring we've got JT joining us. JT, I know you're having kind of an issue, so bear with me. We'll do our best to get through this. But apparently, we are coming across pretty clear on the network. So whatever issue is, it's just on your side. But welcome back.
Thanks for having me, Marc. Great to be here.
Yeah, glad to have you back, my friend. I know it was a good show last week. I thought that we covered a lot of good ground, and so I recommend that to anyone who has not heard that. So go back and listen to last week's show. That's one of the benefits of doing the show pre-record, because we don't have any commercials. So we don't have to and yes, Calvin, I have Audacity going. We don't have any interruptions to the flow of the content of the show. But what I wanted to do, and I know we've got a full boat of calls, show, and I'm glad we're able to do the show, even though we've got this particular tech issue. But what I need to do is about the Freedom Summit last week. I'm going to post the article, because my main objective in going to the Freedom Summit in Phoenix this past weekend was to be able to interview John Buttrick. I was not an invited speaker. I was a vendor. It was a complete disaster as far as I lost my shirt attending. But my main objective, even though I lost my little bit of a shirt that I have by doing it, it was that I wanted to be able to interview a federal magistrate, John Buttrick, and he is, I think, run for governor. He's a member of the Libertarian Party, long time here out in Arizona, and he was a speaker. So yes, he's a federal magistrate in Phoenix, and I wanted to be able to speak to him. And JT, I've told you already, I have 23 minutes of video waiting to be uploaded, and so hopefully I should be able to get that today. I know I'm probably shooting myself in the foot, non-entity. I'm looking at you. I should be able to get it done. All the other videos that I got from last week are up, but it's just this 23-minute video, JT, with a federal magistrate. And it's probably the only time I'm ever going to get to speak to a sitting federal magistrate. And I think the only reason why he spoke to me was, well, he's a nice guy, but he was actually speaking at the Liberty Forum. I did it again. All weekend I called it's the Freedom Summit. Liberty Forum is in New Hampshire very soon. And so what I wanted to just talk about, JT, real quick, is we're going to go into a lot of these issues, because we've got, you know, you were in court yesterday. You were in front of one of these psycho judges. And I'm not saying that John Buttrick is necessarily a psycho. I don't think he is. But I just want to include this video of this segment of the show when we, you know, as a lead in to the video. And I don't want to say too much, just like most of these bureaucrats, JT, and you saw this yesterday, they actually believe that what are just written instruments and their words on paper, their opinions, that they apply to everybody just because they say so.
Yeah, that's what the man said.
Yeah, and we'll get into that, the psychopath Rex Stacy that you have a personal contact with as yesterday. So you saw this firsthand. We'll talk about that a lot. But what it comes out when talking, when you watch this video, and I normally wouldn't allow a bureaucrat or a politician to talk so much. I mean, I was glad that he gave me the time, but what we were trying to accomplish should have been done in 3 minutes. But I let him talk at length quite a bit, and I didn't really resolve anything. But what comes out, and what I'm asking him is, I get the generalization that he's operating from, that just because I am physically in Phoenix, that the constitutional laws apply to me. And so he agreed to that, and then I asked him for actual proof, and what you'll hear is just a lot of legalese trying to justify the lack of evidence and proof that the Constitution laws apply to anybody just because you're physically here. So that's really what took so long, was because he kept on insisting that, not that he used the word magic, but when you listen to this John Buttrick, this federal magistrate, you will hear every explanation basically under the sun except for evidence proving that the Constitution laws actually apply to anybody. And so he actually states a number of times that the applicability of the law, even though it's a part of it is jurisdiction, and it's an element of any code violation, doesn't have to be proven. And it doesn't even seem odd to him to admit something like that. Did we lose? What, did I lose?
Yeah, I'm sorry, Mark. I had a hard time hearing you there.
Yeah, we're going to have to deal with that. But what gets me is somebody claiming to be a libertarian sees no problem.
Okay, hey, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Well, it's just that a federal magistrate, these judges, don't seem to have a problem with the fact that they can't prove that their laws apply to anybody. So I bring out that, of course, the applicability of the law is not just about jurisdiction. It's an element of a violation. He agrees that every element has to be proven beyond a reasonable doubt. But yeah, how do you prove that? By just saying the law applies as a matter of law. I mean, it's circular logic. So what happens, JT, is he actually justifies the lack of proof, the lack of evidence that the code applies to anybody by trying to bring up a straw man type of thing, which...
That's typical.
Yeah, it's just that it was a really odd straw man to kind of bring up, if we can properly call it a straw man, because what he says near the end is, well, he says, well, what is the alternative? I'm like, first of all, I'm not asking you about an alternative. I'm asking you for evidence that your laws apply to anybody. Who gives a damn about the alternative at this point? Show me the evidence. But
right.
Being that he's very good friends with Ernest Hancock, and they go back a long way, and he was given of his time, and actually putting his job on the line, a federal magistrate talking to me, the media, and yes, I had permission. It's in the video. I had him on video say I had permission to record him. But anyway, what he says to me, at a libertarian or an anarchist function where the whole point is to abolish the concept of government and government itself to get to a voluntary society, he wants to distract the attention away from that and says, well, what's the alternative? We all put our robes down and walk away and the system collapses? Yeah. And I said to him, yes, yes, we're at the Freedom Summit. Declare your independence. LRN.FM, you know, it's freedom. Voluntary society, of course. I thought that was kind of odd. I'm like, it was kind of a Twilight Zone moment. Like, you just spoke at an anarchist conference talking about market, you know, market solutions to government. And that basically have everything privatized. No government, no rulers. And he saw that particular alternative wasn't a good enough justification to stop what they're doing. So, before we're at the, I'm going to do my best to get this on the website posted today. But I want honest critiques on this. Obviously, if someone's just going to troll and say I'm an idiot, I'm not going to respond to anything like that. I don't care. But if you believe that John Buttrick in any way presented a lucid, well-reasoned position and evidence to show that the law, the Constitution laws do apply just because of your physical location, then, hey, we're here on the show every Saturday from 1 to 4 p.m. Pacific time and 4 to 7 Eastern Standard Time, and, you know, you're more than happy to present it. So I finish, you know, my position is this, and JT, I think this is as simple as we can make it. If there's no evidence your Constitution laws apply, then they don't apply. You know,
right.
and the law and the Constitution is not magic. We don't believe in magic. So if there's no evidence they apply, they don't apply. My name is Marc Stevens. This is the No State Project for February 22nd, 2014. We'll be back with your calls in just a moment.
Okay, Mr. Buttrick, that your federal judge, magistrate here in Phoenix, it's okay to video?
Sure.
Okay. I do a show called the No State Project. It's where we're looking to get to a voluntary society, have a complete abolition of the not just government itself, but of the concept as a legitimate concept. And so one of the things that I do is I help a lot of people in court. And there's a do you agree with the generalization that the laws and the Constitution, the laws of the United States, apply to everybody in the United States?
I think that's accepted law, yeah. And it should, and obviously it should if you're within this geographic area and you're a citizen, then the constitutional rights go devolved to each individual citizen.
Okay. So what actual evidence has a prosecutor or a plaintiff's counsel ever brought to you to actually prove that the Constitution and Code apply just because someone's physically in North America, this part of North America, let's say Phoenix?
I mean, without proving that they're a resident? Well, I'm see if I follow this. The question is, do prosecutors present evidence that the constitutional provisions apply to individual defendants? I think it's a presumption.
It's a presumption, but is there any, I get that, and I've had federal prosecutors telling me, Norman Smith in particular in Oklahoma, who, when I asked for any actual evidence of the Constitution and laws actually applied, and there was any jurisdiction over me, just because I was physically in the United States,
mm-hmm.
He just thought it was a given. Or, like you saying, like it was a presumption. I've had prosecutors tell me, well, it's the law. But is there any actual evidence that a prosecutor would be able to, should give to convince a reasonable person that the Constitution and laws actually apply just because, let's say, I'm physically in Phoenix?
Yeah, that's a legal question, not a question of evidence. So, for instance, let's say you're in Phoenix and you're alleged to have committed a crime here in Phoenix. And then you're taken in front of either a federal court or, depending on what the nature of the crime, or a state court in Arizona. The issue of whether or not the laws and the Constitution apply to you is a question of law, not a question of, I don't know what evidence. The only evidence would be you are here.
Okay.
And they will put on that evidence. There'll be somebody, they do have to prove that a crime was committed within the jurisdiction, and they'll do that.
The question is, and it gets into kind of a circular loop,
mm-hmm.
The question is one of evidence. So it turns out, is the law being applied arbitrarily, or is it being based on actual facts?
Mm-hmm.
So what facts would you use to prove that just because I'm physically in Phoenix that the Constitution and United States Code apply to me?
You're mixing a factual and a legal question together. The factual issue is, were you here? And that can be proven, and that evidence has to be proven, that you were within this jurisdiction when the crime was committed. The second question you're asking is a legal question. That is, assuming that you committed a crime within the jurisdiction, does this court have jurisdiction over you? And the answer to that is yes, and they don't provide evidence to that effect. That's a matter of case law and statutes.
So it's just circular. The law applies because the law said so, or the law applies because a judge like yourself said so.
Well, the issue of personal jurisdiction, which is what we're talking about.
Well, it's an issue of subject matter jurisdiction, personal jurisdiction. And it really
begs
the question.
Well, subject matter happens what the,
because
depends on what the crime
because
was.
Because the generalization is whether I'm committing a crime, accused of a crime or not.
Mm-hmm.
The fact that I'm physically in Phoenix, that means the Constitution laws apply to me. So
yes.
To back up that argument or that generalization, what evidence is there to actually prove that's true?
Well, you keep talking about evidence that that's true. That that's true is a legal conclusion, not an evidential one.
But it's
for instance, how could you couldn't provide evidence the other way, too. There's no evidence one way or the other related to the issue of whether or not the Constitution and laws apply to someone who commits or is alleged to have committed a crime within a particular jurisdiction. That's not an issue of evidence. That's an issue of whether or not there's personal jurisdiction. The answer to that is yes. But the factual predicate does have to be proven. They do have, in every crime, they have to, in order to get jurisdiction over you, they have to allege and prove that, in fact, that you committed the crime within that physical jurisdiction. That could be done by your own admission, it could be done by a witness, could be done by a photograph, etc. But that has to be presented. If that's not presented, then the case can be dismissed.
But it still begs the question, why are you under the impression I had the opinion, the legal opinion,
mm-hmm.
that the Constitution and laws apply to me just because I'm physically in Phoenix.
It's not just because you're here. Well, it is just because you're here. Because that's the scope
that's
of the
Constitution.
That's the scope?
But how does the Constitution apply to me just because I'm physically in Phoenix?
Well, I don't know what you mean by just because. That is the, in fact, the
it's the argument.
That is the that's the key piece of evidence. That's what it pivots on.
But where is how? Explain exactly the facts, the mechanism that proved the Constitution applies to me just because I'm physically in Phoenix.
Okay. Again, that you're mixing an evidential issue with a legal issue. The evidential issue is, were you here? And again, they have to prove that.
But why? Why is that true? What I'm getting at is, I can say that this piece of paper mm-hmm. applies to you because you're physically in Phoenix. And if you say, well, what evidence do you have that that applies? Well, no, you're mixing the two up.
You are, because because as I was mentioning earlier in the speech, we have a court legal system that has a monopoly over the adjudication of disputes and criminal matters within a specific geographic area, the United States of America. If they couldn't prove that you were here, let's say you were hauled into court here in Arizona, and the allegation was that you murdered somebody in France, then you get to say, wait a minute, how does the Constitution apply to me? I was in France when this murder took place, as was the victim.
Well, actually, that's not true, because Blackmer versus the United States makes it very clear about the jurisdiction issue, personal jurisdiction. It also begs the question that how does somebody violate the copyright laws mm-hmm. when they've never left New Zealand or they've never left Australia? So the physical location is not, you know, because they're being accused of violating it. But it's still, the generalization is that if I'm physically in Phoenix, the Constitution and the laws apply to me, whether I'm accused of a crime or not. My question still is, what actual evidence is there to back up that generalization and prove that, Marc, just because you're physically in Phoenix, the Constitution applies to you?
Okay. Again, it's not a matter of evidence. It's a matter of law.
So it's arbitrary.
Arbitrary in the sense that all laws are arbitrary.
Okay.
in the sense that it could be different. We could have a system that said you don't have personal jurisdiction over anybody unless they're wearing a pink hat. And if there's no allegation that you were wearing a pink hat when you committed the crime, therefore there's no personal jurisdiction. That could be a law. It'd be a silly law, but it could be a law. And would that be arbitrary? You bet. Instead, we have a law that says
Take it back up.
I sort of lost my train of thought.
It is arbitrary.
Yeah. So in that sense, the pink hat rule that I just came up with is completely arbitrary. It could exist. That could be the rule of law in a particular jurisdiction. It'd be a strange rule of law, but that could be it. Instead, what this country, and to my knowledge, virtually every other country, says is that when you're within the geographic description, the geographic areas as to which this Constitution or the laws apply, then you are subject to that constitutional law.
I agree, but other than your say-so as a judge and the say-so of other judges,
mm-hmm.
is there any actual evidence? And I think you've already answered, it's not an issue of evidence, it's a matter of you said
of
so.
Of law, yes.
You said so.
Well, not just because of me.
I could
vaporize tomorrow, but it would still be the law.
But that's because people like yourself, federal judges and attorneys and prosecutors, because they said
the world. And legislatures also.
And, well,
oftentimes the laws are written expressly stating that conferring jurisdiction over particular people and places, etc.
Because they said so.
Because the law says so.
Because,
that's right.
So a question that I had for a federal prosecutor was that if he had no evidence to prove the Constitution and laws apply in the first place, that it was just arbitrarily done because we said so,
mm-hmm.
then how do you prove beyond a reasonable doubt that somebody violated the law if you can't prove beyond a reasonable doubt that the law, you know, applied in the first place?
Right, and the answer is that the issue that the law applied in the first place, beyond a reasonable doubt, the issue is, were you here? And not the issue of whether or not the law applies to somebody who is here. That's a legal conclusion that is subsumed in the whole notion of a constitution and a set of laws and a monopoly a legal system within a particular geographic area. So that's a given.
It's a given? So that's an issue that I've had.
I mean, there are cases on this, law on this. But
those are just opinions.
Well, of course they are. They're written opinions
because
of courts.
Right.
But that's what we call the law.
But the law is just an opinion. What you're saying is that when you as a judge make a determination, mm-hmm. it's different from when I make a determination because it's considered a legal opinion
right.
and that there were men with guns that will actually carry it out.
That is one of the ways to define law also, but that's true enough. But you have to recognize the futility of making that kind of argument to a prosecutor or somebody within the system, because what you're really saying is, hey, this whole system is arbitrary. This whole legal system that you've concocted here. And therefore, yeah. Where's the evidence that it should apply at all?
Sure.
And if the answer to that is, oh my gosh, he's right, then everybody just gets down to, the judge takes his robe off and everybody goes home. And
that would be great.
In his whole legal system. You may think that would be great, but we haven't gotten to that point yet. So when you're within the system arguing, those kind of arguments have no weight.
Well, actually, it's not an argument. It's just a question. All I'm doing is putting forth a question of evidence, and based on what you've told me, that, yes, it's because someone said so, you said so, or these other guys said so. So a lot of times we do have prosecutors realize they don't have
but you knew all of that before you asked the question.
Well, that's true. I mean, I've done this. Right. You're just the first federal judge I've been able to speak to and be able to do this without fear of being thrown in jail for contempt.
Because I'm not going to hold you.
That's why I'm doing this. But we have had things thrown out. There are times, many, many times, the prosecutors realize they don't have a leg to stand on. Because the other thing, too, is the prosecutor, as not a witness or a party, has to rely on witnesses with personal first-hand knowledge.
Correct.
So where would the prosecutor have a witness with personal first-hand knowledge that the Constitution and law applied beyond a reasonable doubt?
They would have a witness and hopefully evidence to prove that you were here. But they don't have to prove... they don't have to prove legal principles. All they have to do is make reference to the law or to opinions and prior rulings about personal jurisdiction.
But that's not...
They don't have to call the other judges as witnesses, for
instance.
Well,
no, because that's not what's happening. Because when you're talking about a legal opinion from a prosecutor or, let's say, an IRS agent, that if they don't have personal first-hand knowledge at the, you know, of the application, because... If you're being accused of violating a code, which is what they're doing, let's say with the IRS, an essential element of that violation would be the applicability of the code. And as the any element, I mean, even Norman Smith admitted that as an element of the crime, it has to be proven beyond a reasonable doubt.
Yes.
But to prove it beyond a reasonable doubt, you don't do that with
political... Yes, but jurisdiction is not an element of the crime.
But
jurisdiction
is
fundamental even beyond the element of the crime. They have to have personal jurisdiction.
But there's no crime without the code. So when you have a mala prohibita, for example, the applicability of the code is an element of the crime. Because without it, there is no... It's only a crime because some legislator, some lawmaker, if you will, said so.
Mm-hmm.
So being an essential element of the crime would have to be proven. And I've had prosecutors admit that, yes, of course the law applies, and yes, it has to be proven beyond a reasonable doubt.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a given. And that's where we disagree, where I don't believe it is a given. If it is your opinion and your argument is that the Constitution and laws apply just because you're physically here, it should be based on evidence, not mere circular logic. Well, it's the law because we said so. Or let's say,
well, it is the law. And your argument, the problem with your argument is it goes too far. No one's going to accept that within the system because, as I say, everybody would just, oh, well, I guess all law is arbitrary. We'll just fold up our tents and go home. Your case is dismissed. Oh, and by the way, the other 10,000 pending cases are also dismissed because we have no jurisdiction over anybody. As I say, proves too much. No one is going to accept that.
Well, you're looking through it through your eyes as a libertarian. The average prosecutor is going to forget my name 2 minutes after I walk out of the office and they've dismissed it.
No, but any judge who's presented with this argument is going to think that.
Well, it's not an argument. What we do is we present a question that the prosecutor hasn't presented the evidence. We want to see the evidence of jurisdiction.
Well, who are you presenting this question to?
Well, we're usually initially to the prosecutor, and then we present it in court through the judge, of course, to the prosecutor.
Now, how's that working for you?
It's been pretty well. It actually has been pretty well.
Because on this argument of no personal jurisdiction?
On the observation, I hate this camera, on the observation that the prosecutor is based, almost his entire case is based on speculation. Well, we think the law applies because the law said so. And you just point out, well, that's a logical fallacy. That's circular logic. It's not evidence. And even like you said,
it's not evidence.
It's not evidence. But in the idea, though, which I think is, I got to admit, I think it's pretty dishonest when we're talking about applying the law and not basing it on evidence. To put people in jail based on, we're going to apply our law, even though it's arbitrary, because we don't want the whole system to fall apart tomorrow. That's not a reason to destroy somebody's life.
Well, no, evidence is necessary to show that the facts of this case confer the personal jurisdiction.
So the evidence to confer jurisdiction?
Yeah, I mean, it's necessary to have a factual basis in order to confer the jurisdiction. But the factual basis is this person was within this geographic area at the time the crime was committed and allegedly committed the crime. That's the basis for the personal jurisdiction argument. The personal jurisdiction concept is a legal concept, not a factual one. And so that law is dependent upon, that derives from either the nature of the Constitution or statute itself, or case-made law over time conferring personal jurisdiction. So,
well, it still begs the question, how does your opinion as a judge or any of these other judges who have made these decisions that the law applies, where are the facts that applies to me at all? Just because judges sit in Phoenix or, mm-hmm. or D.C., just because a lawyer gives an opinion these laws apply to everybody, mm-hmm. what evidence beyond your say-so is there to show it applies?
It's a legal conclusion, so it doesn't rely on evidence. So it relies on what the law is.
It's just an arbitrary decision.
Well, if you want to characterize all law as arbitrary, then that's fine. But again, I think your argument proves too much, because if that's right, if that's what you're saying, then no legal system can proceed.
Well, this particular legal system has no voluntary support. I mean, as a libertarian, you do agree that taxation is theft and that there's no voluntary support. The communities don't want...
Okay, but again, we started by talking about whether or not there was error in conferring personal jurisdiction. You keep saying, where's the evidence
right.
That this Constitution applies to me just because I'm standing here, you say.
Right.
And I think I've answered that.
Right.
And your counter-argument is, well, that's all. Just every time you talk about the law, that just sounds like somebody's arbitrary opinion. And I say to that, well, if that's true, and that were to be applied in court, then no one would be prosecuted for anything, and there'd be no legal system. And I don't know what your counter-argument is to that. Your counter-argument to that is that's fine.
Well, no, I think I agree with most of what you said in your talk.
And that's fine, but that's almost a political position, not a legal position to take inside the courtroom.
Well,
unless you believe that you're going to end up with judges who are going to buy into that and then just dismiss all the cases.
Well, it's not about the judges buying into it. It's just a matter of holding the prosecutor to his burden of proof. Does he have anything more than pure speculation? And
no, he has. Well, all he has is an affidavit from somebody saying he saw this person in this location at the time that this crime was allegedly committed. That's all he's got.
Well, typically what they have is they have that, like in Arizona, for example, I don't know if you've ever done traffic, the police officer is doing a certification that I believe the person named above committed the act and violated section XYZ of the code. Mm-hmm. So the police officer is determining that, one, the code applies to this guy. Mm-hmm. I have jurisdiction. Now, the question still goes to, and I think we've already answered it, that does the police officer have any personal first-hand knowledge of any evidence to prove the Constitution and code apply? And I think you would agree that, no, he doesn't. He just has what judges like yourself
sure.
have told him.
Yeah.
So when I say it's arbitrary, it's because it's based on his say-so, not any actual evidence connecting the two.
Right, okay, and we've gone through this before. He doesn't have any evidence
right.
to offer
okay.
on the issue of what law applies. That's a legal issue. That is up to the judge.
I believe it. You know, if you've got a legal argument that, and it's not supported by evidence, then by definition, it's arbitrary.
Well, again, personal jurisdiction is supported by evidence in the sense that in a given case, there has to be some evidence that the person actually was there. But you're challenging whether or not being there itself is in fact enough to confer a personal jurisdiction.
Yes.
That's a legal question, not a factual question. I don't know what kind of evidence that would be.
There was
an affidavit from the founders of the Constitution? I don't know
that's the whole point. The point why we're doing this is because there is no actual evidence. This is why I can go in and
evidence,
confront.
Yeah, but that's...
Because what we're doing is uncovering the gun in the room, that they're imposing their laws arbitrarily at the point of a gun. And that's what we're bringing out.
Okay. I don't know whether that would be any different than saying, well, you say I committed murder.
Wow.
But where's the evidence that the murder laws apply to me?
Well, that is different.
So. How?
How? Yeah. One,
they have no evidence of that, you would say.
No, they don't have any evidence to last.
All they showed me was me with the gun and the body lying there, where's the evidence that the murder laws apply to me?
There is no evidence that they do.
Well,
but you do have evidence that, that's the problem with having the compulsory system that we have now, that there are going to be certain arguments that you can make like that to try to justify, well, let's destroy the lives of all these people if we can prosecute 0.5% of actual real crimes. But it still stands to reason that, or I think the point is that if all you can say for proof that the law applies is because we said so, well then, you know, that's the point. That there is no evidence the laws apply, you just have a gang of criminals called government that are imposing it on everybody until enough people wake up and say, look, you have no evidence and we're just not going to comply.
You would like Spooner's argument.
Absolutely.
That the Constitution doesn't apply to anybody because you didn't agree to it.
The Constitution is four pieces of paper, and so it stands to reason. No.
Okay. Well, you should try that one, too.
Well, we have. We have. Okay. Real quick, have you done any IRS cases?
No. I've never been involved either as a lawyer or as a judge. IRS cases are all in federal court, and I was in state court for most of my career. And as a magistrate judge, I haven't had that opportunity.
Okay, I got about a minute. So just if an IRS attorney, district counsel, filed a typical copy and paste petition to enforce an IRS summons, which is just a prayer for relief, would you be satisfied that they had filed a valid cause of action and had shown jurisdiction?
I don't know. I'd have to read it, but I don't know. I've never read one of these.
Okay, it was literally just a prayer for relief. He didn't give us this. We want an order compelling him to give us these books and records.
I don't even know the law in this area, okay. So I don't know whether I couldn't even begin to.
Okay, and
that.
I wish I had more time, but I do appreciate your time again. It was
no
John Buttrick, and you're a federal magistrate in Phoenix.
Right.
All right. Excellent. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I do appreciate.